I'm going to sing again, y'all. Oh, no. Miss Donna, we love our t-shirts. Thank you so much. Good job. And we realize, hello, praise God. It's time. It's already 1:30. Praise God. Thank you for those that are streaming with us. We're so thankful. We wish you could be here with us, but I hope you're feeling the same kind of excitement we're feeling in the room with Miss Renee. I know you are. So anyway, I don't want to take up her time. So we will just have her come right on back and get into our second session. Amen. Amen.
Well, I always think afternoon sessions are exciting because you have to keep everybody awake because it's nap time. But if everybody will just, you know, put on your Go Fight Win Tonight shoes and we'll carry on here today. Did anybody learn anything this morning?
Yes.
You know, I always think that I can handle almost everything in life, but I have to figure out how to think about it. I can handle it, but I just need to sort it all out. And I always see it like it's putting a puzzle together. Like this is part of it. This is a fact. This is what happened here. And then if I can begin to put them together in some sort of picture concept, okay, then I can figure it. And I'll have this scripture and that scripture. And this is, okay, Lord, that, and I start gauging everything by whatever I know from the Word. And it's a puzzle, and I've got to put it together and make it look how God wants me to see it, so I'll pray the right prayer. Because the Holy Ghost, turn over, we'll start here real quickly and go to Romans 8. And I think that's really probably the premier look about that helps you understand so much of this. You know, prayer is something we could just talk about forever, right? You know, because it's an earthly thing and it's for this time. We're not going to be doing that after we go to heaven, new heaven and new earth. You know, we'll be so much smarter and all our needs are met. Yes. And our bodies, my first husband, Dean Garner, did so much study on all this. He always felt like we were going to all be at the same age Jesus was when he went to heaven, somewhere between 30 and 33, that's the perfect body. After that, your body starts aging. And he always felt like when we go to heaven, we'll be like him. So that'd be 33. And so when you think about that, then I was really cute at 33. when I say things like that, I hope y'all know I'm joking. I mean, this is fun. You know, you have to think, well, I must have been cuter. You know, I mean, here I am now, you know, five decades later. Oh, my goodness, I must be. Oh, then I'm sure I was cuter. You know, we all look better probably at 33 in some form or fashion, but because you always think younger is better, but younger is dumber. You know, you have to remember you didn't have all the pieces of the puzzle. And I remember the lights coming on at 40, and then even more at 50, and then the lights really came on at 60, and you find yourself, you know, as in the aging process, that there's a recognition of reality, which seems to be where this generation is just somehow lost in Yonkers, you know? I mean, the reality of life has not hit them, you know? And they're trying to live out an unfulfilled childhood that never brought them to a place of personal satisfaction in their life. And I want to point this one thing out to you, because this is really how the devil in his kingdom works on your dissatisfactions. Because if you think about this, Lucifer was in heaven and he was the fourth in line. And he was dissatisfied and said, I'm going to exalt my throne above the throne of God. If you can be dissatisfied in heaven after Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, there you have a serious mental problem.
Right.
Emotional arrogance. To think that your thoughts are somehow accurate. There's an accuracy in that kind of thinking, and that's delusional. He used the same trick. Adam and Eve are in the garden. All their needs are met. They're walking with God in the cool of every day. Everything is perfection around them. And he came in with the same thing that he had, and that was to make them think they didn't, their needs were not, they were dissatisfied in some way. Well, he just doesn't want you to eat of that tree because then you'll be like him, which was his problem to begin with.
Right.
So he makes, that's where you get silly women here also in 2 Timothy, where silly women are burdened down with the load of their own sin, and they listen to anybody that'll teach them because they're so dissatisfied they can't get answers. And it's the same thing. And everybody say dissatisfaction.
Dissatisfaction.
Every person's life at some point or another you're going to have things in your life where you are dissatisfied with the dynamic that you're in. And that's where you kick in that verse that I'm going to pick up my cross and follow the Lord anyway. That's cross-bearing. Cross-bearing is picking up your cross. You know, and our bodies are made like a cross. You know? I mean, I'm the cross. Like I said, if I can survive my own life, hey. But you're the cross. This is who I am. And just like you're laying in bed one morning, you're laying your arms out there, the way the Lord, I got it. And I was just laying there and I sat up like this and I'm picking up my cross. And I'm going to follow the Lord. And that's Monday through Sunday. That's good days, bad days, glad days, sad days, mad days, tax days. It doesn't matter. You pick up your cross and you follow the Lord.
Yes.
And there is that cross, real cross bearing is you're not bearing Jesus' cross. You're not bearing the substitutionary cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. He did that once and for all for us, right?
Yes.
But what you're doing is in obedience, you're picking up your cross and following the Lord to whatever your life's end will be. It's like the Apostle Paul said there also in Acts 20. He said, they asked him, Paul, what is the Lord showing you and where are you going to do? You know, people always have come up to me through my life and have asked me that, Lord, Renee, what's the Lord showing you? And I want to say that I'm going to have a whole lot of garbage in my life. I'm going to meet some really bad, I mean, I want to laugh about it. I want to say, like the Apostle Paul, he said, I know that everywhere I go, I'm going to be thrown in prison. I'm going to have, I mean, I don't want to hear a thus saith the Lord, if you'll follow me, you're going to go to jail. If you follow me, it's going to be lonely at the top. If you follow me, you're not going to have a whole lot of really good friends. If you follow me, you're going to have to do marriage, kids, finances, be healthy, look cute doing it, and stay sharp. You're going to have to do all these things and still follow me. And that's like the Apostle Paul saying, through thick and thin, he said, the only thing the Lord has showed me is that except the Holy Spirit clearly and expressly, emphatically affirms to me in city after city that imprisonment and suffering await me. Now, I don't want to hear that prophecy. But Acts chapter 20, verse 23 says the same thing. That's where we get this famous verse that the Apostle Paul says, but none of these things move me. See, we hear scriptures like that and we all think, oh, isn't that wonderful? And we're so blessed by the purity of the moment. But you don't realize what came. The verse above that says that yeah, you're going to get married and you're going to face every kind of hell you ever thought you were going to face. And if you're going to raise kids, you're going to think you've died and gone to hell. So when you read this verse, Paul says, but none of these things move me. This is the cool part. Neither do I esteem my life dear to myself. I can't be dear to me in the wrong way. He said, but if only I may finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have obtained and which was entrusted to me by the Lord Jesus faithfully to attest to the good news of the gospel and all of his spiritual blessing and mercy. Now, if you're going to say none of these things move me, then you got to me, the key word in all of Romans is the word things. You got to qualify the word things. Which things is he talking about? What is the list of things, plural, that he's talking about? The Apostle Paul's thing, he says, the only thing that the Holy Spirit has made clear to me is that in every city I go to, imprisonment awaits me. God, how do you face that? How do you face that kind of information from heaven that you're going to face? And that's a Roman, ugly, dirty, filthy, sewage, some scholars say was up to their waist. And they're in jail with rats and vermin and people that are actually guilty of what they've been sent in there to do. And yet Paul said, but none of these things move me. Well, then I have to be a better Christian. If I'm going to live up to that, I have to be a better person. I have to be tougher. I have to be honest. I have to be real close to the Holy Ghost so that I know that I'm in the right place doing the right thing. Because if I'm going to be in jail, that still means I'm going to be alive.
Yes.
And I'm still can have influence. Just like Paul said in Romans, all of the people here send their regards to you because we're all in here serving God together. You know, Paul won people to the Lord while he was in jail. Very influential people sometimes came in there. And he won them to the Lord. And he said, we all send you our greeting. So that means I've got to be a tougher, sharper, not count my life dear to myself, and not always try to make things easy and comfortable for me, to put me in areas where I am uncomfortable, where I'm stretched. Go buy yourself a Stretch Armstrong doll and say, I'm going to stretch my faith. Brother Osteen did that. He taught a whole sermon series on Stretch Armstrong. When we were building our building, he said, we're not going to beg, we're going to stretch our faith. And they get old Stretch Armstrong up there. But see, we have to realize that we're living in the days that are just before the coming of the Lord. It's going to require a different kind of Christian. We can't have a 1980s, his banner over me is love, Christian. We can't even have some of the crazy songs that they're singing now that are just foolishness. And you and I we've got to realize this, people are going to go to hell if we don't do our job.
Right.
And if I'm unfaithful to the house of God, I'll probably be unfaithful to you. You know, we excuse ourselves. But Paul said, I don't love my life. Revelation says they overcame him how?
By the blood of the Lamb
and by the word of their testimony. And what's the next part? And they love not their lives unto the death. See, that's where we are. We can't love our life. I have to respect my life. Therefore, I have to lay aside every weight that does so easily beset me, Hebrews 12. I have to keep the focus of what God's called me to do. I have to be honest, upright. I have to get rid of things that would keep me bound to a lower class thinking instead of a much higher class thinking about things. I have to guard my mouth, guard my heart, guard my mind, guard my relationships, because we are those on whom, as 2 Corinthians 10 over there says, we are those on whom the end of the age has come. And we cannot act like we've got 40 years here to play around with this. We have to be tough, hardened soldiers of the cross. And we cannot be entangled in the wrong way with life and yet still be out there on the front line. I mean, I value being bold. I don't want to be intimidated or backward about anything. And yet above all of that is wisdom, because wisdom is the principal thing. And wisdom is so wonderful. I see it like a pyramid. Wisdom is the principal thing. That's what everybody's after. I want the wisdom. Solomon, the wisest man ever lived, wanted wisdom. Give me wisdom. So wisdom's at the top. Wisdom will regulate my faith and my love. I watched an old movie one time years ago, and there was one line in it that was such a profound acknowledgement to me, because I had seen this particular emotion really manipulated spiritually, that Christians have to love all the time. And in this movie, it was a 1930s movie, famous movie, but it was it was a relationship, and he and his wife, and anyway, she had just been very abusive to him over and over and over and over again, and she did it again, and they were about to leave on a cruise, and he found out she had done it again, and he just stood up there while they were sitting at the table, and he called her name. He said, "So-and-so, you know, love just has to stop short of insanity." And I always thought that's pretty much the way it is. It has to stop short, because sometimes we believe too long. I've had family members that lived too long. They didn't have grace to live. You know, you want to live with live a long life and have good days. Isn't that right? And when you're not happy and nobody else is happy and you're making everybody else unhappy, you know, it may be time to let go. I'm thinking, you know, you should have rethought this. That's why we have to pray our prayers way out there. So in the aging process, we're prepared for those hard decisions in life. We're prepared for hearing from God. I need to hear from God about where my life is in my 40s. I need to hear from God about where am I in my 50s, you know? Because all these scriptures, I've written all this stuff out about how the Lord teach us to number our days that we may get us a heart of wisdom. You know, that all my days are written in a book, Psalm 139 says. So God has every second of my life planned. But it's going to take me, full of the Holy Ghost, to hear that plan. So that I don't love my life in the wrong way. And then faith can be abused, because people will just say, you know, you just keep eating like I did today. I had in there Cheetos and chocolate. Well, that's a special moment in time. But if you do that all the time and you don't eat the good stuff, that's like going stabbing yourself and saying, "Okay, Lord, heal that. Okay, Lord, heal that. All right, Lord, heal that." You know, and we abuse faith, and we don't do the things that we should do, and then we want God to do the miraculous for us, and we're not doing the practical. I love the statement by Hudson Taylor, and you know, he lived almost 200 years ago when he went out to China for the first time in the 1850s, and he said that he had found while establishing the China Inland Mission in the most horrific of times, that if you put the practical with the spiritual, it will equal wisdom. So think about that. If I'll do the practical things, God will do the miraculous things. Right?
Yes.
And it'll be wisdom to me. If I'll do the practical things, then the Holy Ghost can be busy about helping me with the supernatural things, the spiritual things, and He'll lead me and guide me into the things that I need to know it with my understanding. Isn't that right?
Yes.
So we need to understand what that word things is, and then how I love my life. Yes. in the right way, that I value my life. My life is important to the kingdom of God. Amen. I told my kids I'd be ready to leave when I'd prayed all my prayers. Because my life, my prayers are the most valuable thing I can leave on the earth for my children. Yes. And my grandchildren. That my who said this? I can't remember now. Prayers are deathless.
Yes, they are.
Prayers are deathless. And if we learn how to pray, even after we're gone, our prayers, I'm always telling I tell the Lord often, I just say, Lord, I'm hooking on to my grandmother's prayers, my great-grandmother's prayers, my mother's prayers, whatever they prayed and they didn't get, I'm going to get.
Amen.
You know, and I just stay on that. Like, I mean, I'm like a bloodhound on so many things because I just refuse to be moved by whatever's happening around me. You know, I mean, I have lived through my first husband's very, very horrific illness. Then the pastoring of the church, all that time, helping, getting all that done. Then 2 years after he was gone, trying to take care of the people that God had left us to deal with. And Christina was a part of that. And then marrying Terry into a whole nother family that always in any room that I'm in, there's always going to be more Mises than there is me, you know. And so many things that I left all my exes in Texas to go meet everybody else in the world, to meet half the known world. I mean, Terry's got like 20,000 people on all his Facebook pages. I mean, there's no way I can. He said, oh, remember I told you about them. I said, no, I don't remember. I don't even know them, and I'm trying to put a name with the face of a story. I said, I remember a story, but tell me. I said, there's no way I can relate to all of that, you know. And this, I went from pastoring in a little orbit to going around the world in time zones that I never knew you could even sleep in. You know? I mean, it's just amazing to me. And I've had to have the grace of God for it and maintain my sanity and maintain the diversity of the lifestyle and lives and the men and the kids and all of that and have the grace of God on me to do it and all the things that go into handling that kind of ministry till I don't even know any way to tell you about it except that it's by the grace of God. If I'm standing here above ground, if any kind of sound, sane mind, it's Jesus. It is just Jesus. And all of it is in the 21st century. I mean, we have cars, we have planes, we have electric can openers, we have, you know, we have electric toothbrushes. I mean, we hardly have to move our wrists, you know. And yet, we live in the most complicated and the most dangerous time that's ever been on the earth. So I don't laud how great our generation is as much as I do how great is our God that can help us still serve God and not give ourselves, like the 2 Timothy 3 here says, lovers of pleasure rather than and more than that of God. That if we don't hold the gospel forth to the world, there is no hope for them no matter how much they invent and how fast the internet is. And how cheap the gas is, it won't make any difference if you're nuts.
That's right.
And if you're going to hell.
Right.
And you're ugly and mean.
Right.
It won't help anything. None of that will matter.
Right.
If you're mean, just impatient, rude, and you're unhappy, and then the devil can use on you that you're dissatisfied. If you're dissatisfied in America, I can't help you. I just can't help you. But it is a tool from hell to tell people that their lives are just terrible. Well, you know, the gospel tells us to not be moved by what we see.
Right.
To get up and walk out.
Amen.
Go do something else.
Right.
I mean, you know, I mean, why he lifted my feet out of the miry clay and put me up on a rock. You know, I mean, God will help you. And sometimes the change has to be first psychologically. You have to, isn't that right? You have to have the psychological change before you ever get a geography change. You know, because if you just get a geography change, you're going to take the same you to the next place. And I don't, if I don't get fixed, I won't be any better. In fact, I might be worse, because if God moves me higher and I'm not higher mentally,
right,
I'll be worse off when I get, after I leave that place.
That's right.
Is that right?
Yes.
Because let the wicked man forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return again unto the Lord. That tells me that that righteous man got off.
Right, right.
And he will return again unto the Lord, and he will abundantly pardon him. For my ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts. For my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. So I need to think higher and act higher everywhere tomorrow more than I did today. I have to be a higher quality person than I was today. I have to have more integrity, more honesty, more compassion, more long-suffering than I was today. And if I'm not growing, the devil's going to find a playground for dissatisfaction. If all I can do is point my finger and blame somebody else because I'm not happy and they didn't make me happy, you know, I would hate to think that I have to every day wake up and make Terry Mize happy. And if I, you know, and that I'm constantly, oh my God, slit my wrist. No, I don't mean that. But I mean the whole thing. I mean, I don't know how people in the world do what they do.
Right.
You know, and that's why they're on drugs and alcohol, and the divorce rate and everything else is where it is. But my job is not to make anybody happy but Jesus. Because if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody going to. I know enough to know that if I don't get me happy and I don't get me blessed, even the proverb woman, it says she stretches out her filled hands to the needy and the poor. If she doesn't have it first, how's she going to give it to somebody else? So I know that I have to have the goods first. God has to bless me. Jesus and I have to be tight. Otherwise, other people will drive you to insanity. They will discourage you, and they won't even mean to. It will just take you to the cleaners if you live by, I'm not happy. I don't ever let those words come out of my mouth. I just say, well. Okay. You know, and if we live by feelings. I mean, there's too many of them in a day. There's just too many of them in a day. And like I said, just if you're dealing with the bureaucracy of our government is enough to make you throw your phone through the window. I mean, I have a sister and a brother that are in nursing facilities and a 92-year-old mother that I take care of every day, wherever I am on the planet. All the insurance, the money, the care, the grocery stores, the food, everything, the doctors, the nurses, everything, rides, transportation, all of this, I'm managing from wherever I am in the day. And then I have three children and eight grandchildren. Terry has eight. We have 16. One, it's always somebody's birthday and somebody needs money. And so my life has to be submitted to the Lord, because there is no way to stay sane and happy and do the work that God's called you to do. Now, does everybody understand that none of these things move me? I have to be unmovable,
right.
Immovable. I have to be immovable. I can have an emotion of disgust. I can be disappointed. Dean always said, I am disappointed many times, but I am never discouraged. And I thought there was such wisdom in that. I can be disappointed, but I don't have to be discouraged. And so that's where we have to find ourselves. And I'm telling you, it does come from the inside. It does not come by somebody laying hands on you. It doesn't come from tenure in the kingdom of God. It comes from a personal decision to mature with life, emotionally and mentally, on the Word of God, and keeping a strong prayer life. Praying in tongues is the premier escapism. I mean, if you'll use tongues, I will escape this mental torment if I'll pray in tongues. If I'll pray in tongues over this, I'll escape the torment of this thing because I won't have to think about it. And the more I pray in tongues, guess what? I build who?
Yourself up.
Me up.
Yeah.
On what?
Holy Spirit.
Terry and I have this ongoing discussion about this because we talk about, you know, the qualifications for faith. No faith, little faith, faith, great faith, the measure of faith. But then I have this other one that says most holy faith. And that's a standard of such greater quality to where you move into that realm of absolute trust in God that you are what? Unmovable. And that's where Jesus lived because he knew. There never was any doubt with him. He always had the answer. And that's the image that I'm going after. Paul said, he said, you foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you so soon? Who has gotten you off of this? I'm going to have to, this is Galatians 4. He said, I'm going to have to travail and birth for you again until Christ be formed in you because you've been bewitched and moved off of the gospel so quick. And see, we can't be moved like that. If none of these things move me, it's like Terry's message on moving the post. You can't move the post and think you're not going to get moved with it.
Right.
You're going to compromise. Compromise comes from when you get deceived, it comes really from a place of probably a thousand little compromises you made till you've lowered your standard and you've moved away from the absolutes of the Word of God. And it was so subtle you didn't even realize. It's like death by a thousand cuts. But it can be the loss of your relationship with the Lord and conscience by a thousand little compromises along the way, and you didn't even realize you did it to yourself.
Right. Wow.
And so that's why we can't be like that. I mean, Pastor Kathy, Joe, and Daryl are in here every week to sound the alarm and say, okay, class, look up here. Everybody remember what we studied last week? Okay, everybody sit up straight in your chairs. Okay, come on, we're going to have a test on this week. You're going to be tested this week. And you have to have the ministry, like Ephesians chapter 4 tells you over there, that you've got to be taught to do the work of the ministry in spite of your lives.
Yes.
In spite of good days and bad days and happy days and sad days. If people love you, applaud you one week, and the next week, like a football stadium, they're throwing beer cans at you. You know, one week they're cheering you, and on any given Sunday is the phrase. Well, that's the same with us. You know, one day they can love you, and the next day they're hollering, crucify him.
Right.
You know, one day everything's wonderful, and the next day your life is in, it looks like it's all burnt down. But we have to be like the Apostle Paul. He said, I've been shown expressly and clearly that what awaits me is imprisonment in every city. I don't ever want to hear that prophecy. But if I do, and obviously we are somewhere close to that, living in this generation, we have to mature to the place that none of these things move us, right?
Amen.
Then Romans chapter 8. I want to show you that real quickly. I remind you, I think I've shared some of this. But just look here at this. Down in verse, and I'll just give you clues here. Verse 26, so too the Holy Spirit comes to our aid. Amen?
Amen.
And for we don't know how to pray, but the Holy Ghost does. Hallelujah.
Amen.
It says he goes out to meet our supplication and pleads our behalf with unspeakable yearnings and groanings too deep for utterance. Brother Hagin always taught us that what that literally, he got it from a Greek scholar, literally means is that the Holy Ghost takes hold together with you against whatever is out there that you're praying about. The Holy Ghost joins arms with you, takes hold together with you against whatever's coming against you. So that he goes out to meet our prayer of, oh God, what are we going to do? And he said, okay, let me take over. Let me pray here for you, with you. And we're going to take hold together with this against this issue. So the Holy Spirit joins with you in prayer. And then it says, I love verse 27. He searches the hearts of men and he knows what is in the mind of the Holy Spirit and what his intent is, because the Spirit intercedes and pleads before God on behalf of the saints according to and in harmony with God. Verse 28, we are assured and know that God, at being a partner with them, all things will work together for their good. Now, what things is he talking about there? If God's being a partner with them, if the Holy Spirit's going out to meet your supplication, what does the word things there mean? What things? He's talking about God's come to be a partner with you. If God's coming to be a partner with you, what's he bringing with him? He's bringing what? The Holy Ghost? The Word? The name of Jesus? The blood? Angels? The fivefold ministry? I mean, he's bringing that. When God comes to partner with you by the Holy Ghost, all the things of the kingdom of God are going to be at work for your good. He's not talking about car wrecks and cancer and divorce and money lack. Because this thing has to be, the whole thing is about God being a partner with you, the Holy Spirit coming to our aid. He's searching in your heart to know how to communicate with you, because he knows what is in the mind of God, and he's been up there interceding for you. Right. And he knows what God wants to do for you, but he's got a problem of having to get that into your understanding. Mm-hmm. So he's trying to help you pray that thing through so that the lights come on.
Amen.
And you know what to do. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Because we have to see this in the realm of the Spirit.
Right.
We have to see what's happening here. So the word things, all things will work together for your good, are the things of the kingdom, the supernatural things.
Hallelujah.
God's not doing, he's not, it's just like Jesus said, you can't have bitter and sweet water coming out of the same vessel. A kingdom divided against itself will not stand. You can't have God using the kingdom of darkness to bring you to revelation.
Right.
That's not going to work. It's like trying to mix oil with water. Those two kingdoms do not work together.
Right.
Now, and we can qualify that by saying, well, you know, the devil's done his best and God will just turn it around. But he's not going to use that.
That's right.
He's going to use his power.
Yes.
His word.
Yes.
And he's going to work with you.
Yes.
As you pray in tongues and pray the will of God. Where? Out of the mind of God into the earth.
Amen.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
Now that puts that scripture on a much higher class.
Yes.
Understanding. Than it does us trying to justify, well, I guess God used that car wreck, you know, you just had, you know. No, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy. And if you've got a brain and you can listen to the Holy Ghost, it doesn't matter what the devil does. All the things of the kingdom of God are going to come to work for you. You're not going to have to depend on tragedy and all of these things, triumph over tragedy and all these goofy things, and God is in control. You're not going to have to say stuff like that. This has got to be a much higher understanding that we are working together with God by the Holy Ghost from the inside of the great. Dean had this great phrase where he'd always say, he said, that great unseen inside part of you. Isn't that noble?
Yeah.
That great, unseen, inside part of me that qualifies me to live for eternity with Almighty God who created everything I see, hear, feel, taste, and smell.
Amen.
It's that great, you ought to go home and make big signs that say that great, unseen, inside part of me is filled with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
See, it puts you on a much higher class level of authority and dominion. Terry preaches so much on authority and dominion, spiritual authority, but it has to come out of you, not just a document handed to you or a preacher preaching to you. It has to come out of you that God controls your life by his power and his wisdom. His power that lives in you, his wisdom that comes off of these pages and literally walks off the page and gets down on the inside of you.
Amen.
I mean, those words, Pastor Darrell, I found a verse in 1 Timothy 3 weeks ago that has just made me want to just literally, I mean, slap my grandma. I mean, it was so, I mean, I just thought, oh my gosh, I'd never seen this before. 1 Timothy 1, Paul lists all these things where people, he said, made shipwreck, blah, blah, blah. He said, and they laid that aside and they did this and that. He said, but he said, God has called me to preach the glorious gospel of the blessed God. Isn't that a magnificent phrase? Amen. I have just danced all over my house, yelled and screamed till I woke Terry up. I mean, I was just saying, the glorious gospel of the blessed God. Yes. I mean, that puts me in a position so much higher than we come from Texas with a big, you know. I mean, that it just puts me so much higher up there than deep in the heart of, I mean, it just puts me in a much higher place that I am an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ, and I am seated at the right hand of the throne of God, and my name is written in the Lamb's book of life. I have reservations. I will never be homeless. I am a child of God, and He lives in me, and I pray up on my most holy faith, because the Holy Ghost in me is searching them. He knows what's in the mind of God, and He's here to help me figure it out and understand it in my head. And all the things of the kingdom of God have come with Him, God being a partner with us. Amen. Everybody say that. Say, God's a partner with me. What a partner. What a partner. That brings new meaning to howdy partner, you know. I mean, partner with me.
Yes.
He's bringing all the things of the kingdom of God that work out for my good.
Amen.
Man, that ought to just make it worth coming here today to hear that, because that entices me to pray more than I've ever prayed before, because I know what's surrounded me. The angel. I have a great friend named Donna Perugini, and you can look her up on Google. She has written some of the greatest children's books, and one of them is called Do Angels Go Camping? Were you in the church when Donna was there, Donna and Dick? They live way up in Washington. They're just some of the finest people on the planet. And she wrote a book. She's written several books, The Flight of Amelia Earhart, which is they're just great, great books. And this book on Do Angels Go Camping, and explains to children how the angels of the Lord are encamped round about. And it's just such a powerful application. Another book is called Don't Hug a Grudge. And it shows this little kid holding this little bad looking little demon. And he's just holding him here. And its name is Grudge. And it's such a great little children's book, but I mean, a lot of adults could really benefit from that. She has such revelation on those things to know that the angels, I mean, you get to where you become so much more sensitive, even on a child's book like that, to realize that the things of the kingdom of God are at our disposal. And the Holy Ghost is trying to pray through you to give you the advantage of having them all working for you in a crisis, all working for you in a decision. All the things of the kingdom of God are coming to work together with you, to partner. God being a partner with you is coming to work together with you, and they're going to help you through this situation.
Amen.
And they'll help you day to day. I mean, crisis, good times, bad times, that's the whole work of the things. That's why I said this word things is so important. And look down here at the next part. Yes, it's so... when you read 28, 29, and 30, he tells you all about the advantages of being in the kingdom of God. And then verse 31 says, what shall we say to all these things? Circle the word things there. Circle the word things over in Romans 8, 28. And you'll see that the word things there is talking about your covenant, the things of the covenant, the things of if he foreknew whom he was aware of and loved, he also destined. In other words, this is how the kingdom works. This is how it's going to work through you. This is how you need to see the kingdom of God. So then he says, what are you going to say to all of these things? In other words, are you going to accept it or reject it? Or you think this is good or this is bad? He said, his answer is, he answers with a question. If God be for us, then who can be against us? Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? I just find that stunning. Then look down. As you read on down through there, it's talking about who is there that will condemn us, verse 34. He said, who shall ever separate? Now, there's just questions and questions and questions. Who shall ever separate us from the love of God? Shall suffering or affliction or tribulation or calamity or distress, persecutions or hunger or destitution or peril or the sword? Even it is written, for thy sake, Lord, it looks like we're being killed all the day long. He said, we're counted as sheep for the slaughter. Verse 37, yet. Oh, I love the word yet. I've gotten to where I love the word yet. Yet will I. Amid all these, what? Amid all these things, we are more than conquerors. And very last one, neither height nor depth, verse 39, neither height nor depth nor any such, no things, no things. Go home and read that out loud. Teach it to yourself. Because in this chapter, you'll see the category of things that he's talking about. Each one of those has a category of things. And you have to understand what things he's talking about. And yet Christians, so many times when we pray, we just treat prayer like a scattershot, shotgun, and we just bleh, out there. When God's trying to help you understand that there's a very classy way to beat the devil up when you've got everything you need to beat him with.
Amen.
I mean, you hardly, it's like Jesus just say, come out of him.
Right.
Lazarus, come forth. Peace, be still. I mean, prayer does that. But prayer is based on knowledge and words. So the word and the spirit must agree. You have to have the information and the vocabulary out of this book. And you have to be filled with the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Brother Osteen said 35 years ago at a convention, we were there at Lakewood, and he said, it's going to come down to in the last days that it's going to be who can listen to the Holy Ghost will survive.
Amen.
Who can hear the voice of God? You know, because when you get to heaven, you're going to know everything. You're going to know every verse. You're going to understand Daniel's 70 weeks. You're going to understand the book of Revelation. You're going to understand what happened during the flood and all those things in the Old Testament. But what we need to hear right now is pray the prayers we need to pray to get God and the earth to do what we need him to do.
Yes.
And turn the tide in this country.
Amen.
And we need to hear his voice for our personal life.
Yes.
To make the intelligent, sound, sane, wise decisions that we need to make.
Amen.
You know, when you're believing God for your health and you've gotten a bad sentence, report from the doctor, they don't know what it is, or you've only got so long to live, or it's incurable, you have to get out of bed every day and hear the voice of God of what is going to be my act of faith today.
That's right. Yeah.
How am I going to think about this thing? I can't think like I've been thinking and think it's going to be any different.
That's right.
I've got to hear from God today. I've got to have fresh manna today. I can't do what last Friday did. I have to do today. And so when you're believing God for finances, and money has to come from other people, it has to come from other directions. Your job every day is intercessory prayer that those that can turn the tide for you financially somehow obey God. And that you're in the right place at the right time. God,
yes.
I always pray how that God will wake up King Ahasuerus if he has to in the middle of 3 o'clock in the morning, take his sleep from him, and they suddenly remember my name.
Amen.
That God will wake up the mighty men, you know, that God will wake up people that are in authority, people that have the ability. There are a lot of people that want to help you financially if you're in the ministry or you have a need or whatever it is, but they don't have the money to help you. If they had the money, they'd help you. But you've got to wake up people that have money. Or you have to wake up and pray for intercessors that'll pray and help you with it. I always ask the Lord for intercessors. I said, Lord, I need intercessors on this thing. Will you add some people with me today to pray? And I don't know who they are because it has still has to be by the Holy Ghost. So I could call 10 people and maybe none of them have an unction to pray for me. Or I could call 2 people and one of them do. You know, because you don't know that. So I have to depend on the Holy Ghost to wake up people to pray for me. You know, and I mean, you just know how, if when you learn more and more and more about prayer, it's just is something that is just like finding my Bible. I was up at all hours of the night in the bathroom, not wake up Terry, shut the door, put a towel over my mouth and start yelling at my Bible to come back to me. Angels, you find them. Angels, you wake up those people. Whoever has my Bible, nag them, Holy Ghost. I mean, I'm like this the whole, and I'm praying. I'm interceding. I'm pleading my case. This is my Bible. I'm not going to lose my Bible. Lord, and I mean, I told God everything I thought about that Bible. Because I have saved all my Bibles to give to my children. Amen. And my grandchildren now. And so I want, those are dear to me. It's what I have, this particular Bible, I have survived. All of my first husband's death, illness and death. The 2 years after him and the 5.5 years I've been married to Terry, this Bible has gotten me through all of that. So it is a sacred document. And that's why it's so, I mean, I have written on there, I mean, things that are trophies between the Holy Ghost and I. I've written them in shorthand so nobody knows but Jesus and I. I mean, little things to me, not real shorthand. But, I mean, just things that I know in there that are mine between the Lord and I. So I want you to see that. Does that help?
Yes.
Does that help? All right. Now, when you pray, you ought to pray long enough at some point during the week where your language change. It'll change back. Pray long in tongues because your language will change. I grew up around Pentecostals. Did y'all notice all those hankies on there today? They all have hankies. Yes. See, I grew up with hanky waving intercessors and singers. Everybody had a hanky because when the Holy Ghost started moving, all those hankies went up. And it was like a battle cry. Wherever the hanky was, you knew the Holy Ghost was moving. That woman, that man that had a handkerchief and the ladies that had a hanky, if that hanky went up, we were having church, you know? And all those Pentecostal women, they got big ones nowadays. And I mean, they're out there. They've all got those hankies. Yeah, we use them to wipe sweat, but they're still there. To help us worship the Lord. I mean, I salute hankies. I grew up with a generation of women that carried beautiful handkerchiefs. Flowers, crocheted around the edges, tatting. All of that beautiful art form were on those hankies. And those hankies are sacred because they were cloths that we prayed over and laid on the sick. They were cloths that we waved the banner of praise and worship to the Lord with. They were cloths, hand cloths and handkerchiefs that we used to worship God with when the music was good. I mean, those were just, and it was a whole era of people. And it's sort of a lost form of worship, sadly. But I mean, I like hats too. I wish hats were back in. But, but you know, another whole realm of life is that we express the passion that's in us. But it's for God.
Amen.
It's for the Lord. And you know, I mean, there's so many things. I love y'all so much. I wish I could just stay here with you and order fried chicken. And we just keep going on this. But I want to show you this because I want to show you when this verse here in Romans 8:28, where it says the Holy Spirit knows what is in the mind of God and he searches the hearts of men to show you. Now, if he's going to search you and reveal to you, I want you to turn to Hebrews Chapter 4, real quickly. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Because the Word of God, I went back for my own personal study in preparation for this meeting. I went back for my own personal study and just read everything in the Word that I could about the Word of God. Like it's the Word is profitable for rebuke and for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly proved, and then that the Lord scourges every son whom he loves, unless you are, so that you're a legitimate child and not an illegitimate child. But how many of you know God doesn't scourge or correct or purge you with a car wreck?
Right.
You know, he scourges from the inside out.
Right.
Hell scourges you from the outside in.
Right.
And so we want to, if God corrects me, I want to do it in the privacy of my own heart. How about you?
Yes.
I don't want any TV cameras. No. I don't want anybody else to know. I love the fact that the Holy Ghost can correct me on the inside and leave me with my dignity. Yes. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Now, in this scripture, when I found this scripture 40-something years ago in the Amplified Bible, in Hebrews 4:12, I had only ever known it in the King James. It says, "For the word that God speaks is alive and full of power, making it active, operative, energizing, and effective. It is sharper, the word is sharper than any two-edged sword, and it will penetrate to the dividing line of the breath of life, the soul, the spirit, and the joints and the marrow," and the Amplified says, "of the deepest parts of our nature, exposing and sifting and analyzing and judging the very thoughts and purposes of the heart." Now, what God tries to do with His Word, it says He sifts it. He sifts. And you know, if you've ever sifted flour, what you're looking for are those rocks. What you're looking for are those clumps. What you're looking for is something that won't pass through here. And you want what's going to come out is going to be a very fine, airy consistency. Isn't that right?
Yes.
That can be worked with, and the flavor is enhanced because of the sifting when you do this. My mother was a fabulous baker. And I'm telling you, everybody wanted my mother's cakes. She almost didn't get invited places if she wasn't bringing a cake, you know. And so here, this is what, think about the Word of God sifting you. And He says it's going to divide asunder the soul from the spirit, the joints from the marrow. It's going to show you what's a thought in your mind and what is the real wisdom in your spirit. But only the Word can do that. And sometimes you don't even know where to start in your Bible, but just start. Go to Psalm 119 and start reading it out loud. It's the largest chapter in the Bible. All it's doing is talking about your relationship to the Word. If you want your own personal revival, take 119, read it out loud, and start confessing it over yourself. And it's almost a surefire thing. You're going to get direction.
Amen.
Because Psalm 119, I've proved in it over and over. In times when I've just been like, eh. You know, your flesh doesn't always feel like doing something spiritual.
Right.
You know, I want to watch John Wayne. You know, I want to watch, you know, somebody get the bad guys.
Yeah.
You know, but yet I know I've got to, I need to go spend time with the Word. I've got to get an answer from God. So no, we're not going to do something to the soul. Yeah. We're going to do something for the spirit. Because I need the wisdom out of that realm that I'd never get out of this realm. So the Holy Ghost, if I start reading my Bible, the Holy Ghost starts sifting. And He's trying to search you by the Holy Ghost. As you read the Word, the Holy Ghost is teaching you, and certain words will start jumping out. And He'll start doing that. And then it says He sifts and He analyzes. This is what the Word does. It starts, if you'll let Him, how many of you want to let Him? Now listen, I know a lot of adults that don't want God, even people in the ministry, that don't want God to bother them. They've done it too long. They've had, you know, too much of a run. Things are good. You know, they've had all the good things that God's, and they just figure everything's all right. But I don't think, from what I read in the New Testament, that this process should stop. It says that He'll keep on doing this right up until the day of His appearing. So is He's going to analyze. You let the Holy Ghost analyze you from the Word. And you don't assume you're right. Now, I'm giving you some stuff here that'll help you. I don't know how long I'm supposed to go here, but I want you to... But just think about this. Get yourself out a sifter, a magnifying glass, so you can... Or a chemistry magnifier. And just begin to let the Holy Ghost look at your heart, look at your thoughts. Let the unrighteous man forsake his way, and Let the unrighteous man forsake his way and the wicked man his thoughts. So we know that thoughts are a way for the enemy to begin to take hold of you with a thought. So it behooves you to be smart enough to inspect your thoughts. Lord, are my thoughts pleasing to you, right? So here's the magnifying glass. And then it says, he will sift and analyze and he will expose. He'll shine a light on it. He'll get that flashlight out there and he'll put a light on it and he'll say, you need to fix this. Or you need to do more of this. You've done it a little bit, but you hadn't been doing enough of it. Or you need to stop going over there. You need to stop letting that person manipulate you.
Right.
You need to, your attitude's been wrong about that person. You need to get your attitude right. And all this is going on while you're reading the Word.
Right.
Or my daughter's raising three little girls, little bitty, tiny things. And they've got a big, loud daddy that works all the time. And here's my little Abigail at home with three little tiny baby girls, and they're all three as different as they can be. And you can't use one size fits all. There are general rules that apply, but every child has a particular bent. And I'm telling you, I thought I was going to go to, I mean, I had died and gone to hell when I was raising my children. I mean, there were, not my first one, but the other two were just, I mean, they were just, my first one was like angelic. I thought, oh, this is great. But then that other one came along, and I mean, he was like, it was like Katie bar the door. And then my little girl was worse than both of them, both my boys. So every time I have gone to the Word and gotten anything, it's out of desperation. I have gotten nothing sitting on the mountaintop waiting for the Lord to pass by. All of mine has been, oh, God, help! You know, everything I've ever gotten from the Lord has been, I've just been a desperate woman my whole life. I've just been on the brink of disaster if God didn't move, you know? So the Lord, it's so valuable and helpful to me for God to show me where I'm wrong, to show me what I'm not doing right. If I didn't think about that right, or I came up with a phrase. Don't anybody steal this from me. I'm going to write a book on this. Carelessly carnal. How do you like that? I didn't mean to be, but I was just carelessly carnal about that, you know? And I was just, you know, I've got a bunch of these and I was going to use this. And I thought, you know, that's where most good-hearted Christians miss it, is on the dinky stuff that we just do over and over, and we're too lazy or too dumb to fix it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I need it analyzed. I need the Lord to sift and analyze. I need it exposed. Just rip me up and then put me all back together again. Right? Right?
Yeah.
Because then it'll be better.
Yeah.
Then it'll be better.
Yes.
You know? No correction seems pleasant at the time, but it yields a more peaceable fruit of righteousness in your life. Isn't that right?
Yes.
And then the fourth one is here. It will sift and analyze and expose and judge.
Ooh.
Guilty or innocent.
Amen.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
I mean, that's what the Word does in a process. Look at that. I mean, that's just wonderful. To have the idea that the Word of God is working for me on the inside, to help me understand and work with the Holy Ghost, who's searching me, trying to help me understand what is in the mind of God on my life, my marriage, my kids, my money, my finances, whether to buy this house or go here or live here or do that. The Holy Ghost knows all of that.
Yeah, he does.
And if I'll let the Word of God work with the Spirit of God in me, they will partner together in me to help get it up to my brain, and I can go, yes, that's it. You know? Now, one more thing. You have to get this, because this is primary to God working in you. And I promise you, the more you let God work in you, prayer is going to get easy. You're going to start seeing more of your prayers answered. And don't get hung up on how I've failed God. And I'm not, you know, don't just, oh, I just failed the Lord. Listen, I'm older than most of you here. Maybe not, but I'm older than just about everybody in this room. And I have just seen, it doesn't matter What causes failure is quitting. Dean always said this too. I thought it was so great. He said, you know, if you don't show up, nothing else matters. I always thought, well, that's pretty, if I quit, nothing else matters. If I don't show up, nothing else matters. But look here at Ephesians chapter 2. I'm just going to read this one verse to you. He's talking about here, he's in verse 12. This is like, in the Amplified Bible, this is like the longest verse in the New Testament in the Amplified Bible. It has so much vocabulary. Have y'all ever heard that scripture that says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling? Okay, well, look at this. Paul is saying in the first half of this verse, he said, whether I'm there or I'm not there, I want you to do this as your goal, to work out your own salvation. Everybody say, it's my job, to work out the great salvation God's given me. Now look up here just a moment. It's your job to find out how God wants you to live out His promises. You can't live Brandy's life. You can't live Evie's life. You've got to live your life. Isn't that right? You've got to live the life and the path that God has called you to do. So he's saying, work out your own salvation. But look here, he says here, complete your own salvation with reverence. Listen to this vocabulary. I love this vocabulary in this verse. And awe and trembling, self-distrust, with serious caution, tenderness of conscience, watchfulness against temptation, timidly shrinking from whatever might offend God and discredit the name of Christ. Yes. Now there's a depth to that that is anything but flippant. Mm-hmm. There is a depth in that to handle my life, I have to do it in reverence. Yes. I have to be reverent about the handling of my life and the decisions that I make. I have to do it with awe and trembling, and I cannot trust me. I can't trust my soul. I can't trust what my likes or dislikes. I have to listen to the Lord. It says, with reverence and awe and trembling and self-distrust, with serious caution, tenderness of conscience, watchfulness against temptation, timidly shrinking from whatever might offend God and discredit the name of Christ. Now there's hope. In verse 13 it says, now don't try to do this in your own strength. For God is what? All the while at work in you, both to will and to do His good pleasure. In other words, God will help you. You don't have to try to attain a perfect act of salvation every day, because you're learning how to live from the inside out rather than from the outside in, because you're allowing the Word of God to sift and analyze and expose and judge the deepest parts of your nature, right down to the dividing of the soul and the spirit. You know, your body's going to stay here. Your soul and your spirit's going to heaven. Right. But your spirit is God's responsibility. But your mind, will, and emotions and your body are your responsibility. So it's always going to be that 2 out of 3, you know, one way or another. But I want you to see here that God's trying to help you value your life. Yes. That the decisions that I make cannot be careless, flippant decisions. That I am to work out the living of my Christian life with tenderness of conscience, serious mistrust of my own flesh. Paul, you know, like I said earlier today, the Apostle Paul said that, he said, I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews, and I still don't put any confidence in my flesh. Isn't that right? Well, if Paul can't trust his own flesh, where does that leave us? If Solomon couldn't find but one good man, none in his harem, because he went to the wrong places. He's looking for love in all the wrong places. He said, I can't find one in my harem. I thought, well, duh. You know, you got some ungodly women there that you chose out of the lust of your flesh instead of going to church and find the one good girl that, you know, could actually do everything, you know. I mean, they could walk and chew gum at the same time. I mean, You know, I mean, it's just amazing to me how we go to the world for things, and then we're going to come back to the house with hangovers and diseases and the next morning. And then we want God to help us. He's merciful. But I tell you what, I mean, these are things that why God's trying to help us not get over into those realms. And we've got to be in that realm where we treat our life with such respect, with tenderness of conscience, serious mistrust, that we do not think, well, I'm okay. Well, I didn't do that. Well, I know that. Well, I know that. Well, I know that. Well, you don't know it. If you're not doing it, you don't know it. And if you're flippant about it and you don't treat it with reverence and awe and trembling, that our righteousness is not built on who we are in the natural. It's a free gift from God, and I need to honor that with such respect that I work out my obedience. In other words, I'm working out my salvation. In other words, what that's actually saying, let me rephrase it, that I'm working out how to obey God within the confines of His Word and how He wants me to fit in to my generation. Because if my life belongs to God, then He has a place for it to fit in the body. People would come to our church often and they would say, well, I just don't seem to fit in any church. And I was so close. I always wanted to just say, well, cut that cone head off. So you're not the hunchback of Corpus Christi. Cut that pump off. You know, cone heads, y'all remember cone heads? I said, oh, you're the cone head. That's what I thought in my head. Oh, it doesn't have anything to do with you not fitting in. It's like somebody took the piece of your puzzle and chopped it off. And you didn't get it right. You know, you were thinking about yourself wrong. You weren't thinking about yourself in the right way. So therefore, you didn't fit in the place God wanted you to fit because you haven't worked out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And you don't realize how important your life is, nor have you honed your skills over here where you should have. So you're ill at ease, insecure, and you don't feel like you're, you know, you can't do that. Where everything that, first off, you have to realize that everything God's ever going to ask you to do, you're probably not going to feel qualified to do. I don't have enough money. I can't give that offering. I can't go there. I'll go where you want me to go if I have the plane fare, you know. I mean, it's like all of those things in life. But if you're not allowing the Word of God to sift and analyze and expose and judge the deepest parts of your nature, it gets down on the inside in there where you work out your own salvation with fear and trembling and reverence and awe and tenderness of conscience and serious mistrust, watchfulness against temptation. I mean, looking at all of this, that vocabulary, does that vocabulary help y'all?
Yes.
I mean, that helps me understand more. I don't, you know, I may just be the word, the vocabulary junkie, but I just feel like this is so important to us understand, because if you don't have that confidence in prayer, you don't believe your prayers are going to, you're not used to hearing from God.
Right.
You always want somebody else to agree with you or hear from God for you, or you're looking for the, like a silly woman there in 2 Timothy 3, you're trying to listen, go to meeting after meeting and everything, and everybody try to teach you and tell you and listen, and you still don't have confidence to hear from God for yourself. And you're a codependent junkie, which should not happen to a woman of God. I want to be a Deborah out there where I'm leading the pack. I want to be JL. I want to drive that tent spike. I mean, when you think about women in the Bible that did some of the wildest stuff, I mean, there's just wonderful things that you just think, there ought to be a fierceness on the inside of us and a ready to fight to go out there and do the things that would make a normal person afraid.
Yes.
But we're fearless because we've heard from God.
Right.
Not because we're smart aleck and we're going to tell the world. You know, the opposite of everybody that's on The View is the counterfeit for who we really are in the Spirit. And that's how we have to be. I don't mind somebody being bold and brash and just out there with it, as long as I know on the inside, and really none of that's any of our business. It's just that on the inside, how I want to be, I want to have that soft tenderness ready to obey God at any moment. And yet, don't mess with me, hell. You know, I mean, it doesn't matter. It's not about me. It's about the Word of God on the inside of me, and you will not diminish that. I know what God's Word says. I know what the Word means to me. I know how it's brought me out of the miry clay. I know how it's delivered me. I know how it's restored me. I know how it's renewed my youth. I know how it's restored my soul. I told Terry about 3 years ago, I said, okay, I'm all better now. I'm done. I'm through. I'm good. You know, good days, bad days, doesn't matter. I don't care. You know, I'm ready to go. It just doesn't matter. Because though none go with me, still I will follow. It doesn't matter. And I just came to a place to where I had been so emotionally fraught. I mean, Kathy Jo, I think I almost had PTSD. You know, just from the stress of all of those things. And I just got to where I just thought, I won. I have come out of this. And I have won. And I am not codependent on anything.
Amen.
I am in a position now to where, though none go with me, still I will follow. And I just don't give a rip.
Amen.
And I'm in that place to where, I love, Terry and I just have such a good time together. I mean, when we're out there traveling and going around and doing the ministry and doing those podcasts, we have such a good time. And yet, you know, I mean, you could just say things can turn on a dime. You know, people aren't getting any younger, you know. And you just think, what if? What if? You know, and I've already lived through some what ifs. And I've just figured out that, my goodness gracious, Christina, I mean, look how far we've come by faith. We just didn't quit. We just didn't quit. And there has to be the maturity on the inside of you is just comes to a place to where, you know, take this whole world, but give me Jesus.
Amen.
I'd rather have Jesus than anything. And yet I am the most gregarious. I mean, I love people. I love serving people. I love loving people. I love giving gifts. I love the hugging and all of the things that go along with friends and friendships and family. I mean, the first thing we're going to do when you get to heaven is eat.
Yeah.
So it's all about the party. It's all about the party. And I love the party. I always thought, they just won't have a good enough party if I don't go. The party will be better if I go. I'd tell my mother that when I was in grade school, but it'll be better if I go, you know. I just know that on the inside of me, I have a party. And I have good things to say that'll help people. And they may need me, may not, but they might need me. And I want to be available to anybody that needs me. And I don't want to be over in a ditch having a breakdown, having a bad day. I don't even know if I've ever had a bad hair day. Ask other people if I've had a bad hair day. But to me, I was like Fonzie. If my hair didn't do it, I'd go, you know. You know, you step back and you come and you go and you think, wait. And I was going to go, good hair day, bad hair day. I was going to go do what I was going to go do. I was going to go to school. I was going to go to work. I was going to go to see my friends. I was going to go on vacation. I was going to church. It didn't matter. Because it wasn't about the hair. It was about what was in me, on the inside of me. Does this help anybody today?
Yes.
You know, I would just love to just keep it going for hours, not because of me, but because I know I've got information. But other than that, I'm willing to sit down here. But I want you just throw both hands up and pray in tongues for 60 seconds. Endo la bahashita la bahosanda. Oh, come on. After all the teaching I've given, let's get louder. Hallelujah. Dielombra devere bahashatika lambro talimaha yesa la bahashate. Yelondo la bahadila diavara bohoshanda. Yes, the lavato parabadia vara bohoshata. Yeda la bahashada. Yes, odo bahasa. Tikalamondo. Elabadeva la badi la bodola badia vanamashita la boso do. Lebra diva la bahashate. Kalimondo reparate. 30 seconds more. Dila bahjada vara bahasada.
And everybody said,
next time you get some stupid thought, throw both hands up and pray in tongues for 60 seconds at the top of your lungs.
Amen.
And if you have a nearby pot and pan and a metal spoon, just beat the fire out of it. And you'll scare away every demon that's trying to harass you and oppress you in your house. But I found out, I even said to Terry the other day, I said, I don't know about this. I said, go in the bedroom and pray 15 minutes and come back out and tell me what you think. And I tell my kids this all the time. I said, before you go, sit in your car and pray for 15 minutes in tongues. I said, don't just go into something blind, cold turkey, you know, get in a hurry, leave time for your praying. And I said, because you want to hear those last minute thoughts in your head before you head in there. To go meet these people and deal with that business situation. If the more you pray in tongues and you have a lifestyle of it, I mean, there's so much in the Word. I mean, it's just amazing to me. The prayer of the upright is God's delight. I mean, all these great scriptures. We shall go speedily to prayer, you know. I mean, we'll come together on the mountains and they'll pray prayers for the future. Jeremiah 31. I mean, there's all these wonderful things that God has... people that are unfulfilled and dissatisfied and always looking for somebody else to make them happy about everything is because they're not fulfilled in their prayer life. They're not fulfilled in their relationship with the Lord. So they're not. So they're unhappy perpetually with it, with other people. And we just can't be like that.
Amen.
You know, I just refuse to be that unhappy person. Not because of a standard, but because I know it's available to me to be like that. Why would I choose my way when His way is perfect? His way is higher. His way is more profitable. His way will reap benefits for me. Hey, I found a verse in Isaiah 64 about 3 months ago. It says, Lord, You did things for us we did not even expect. Isn't that awesome? I just went, I think I'll just think about that for a whole month. I'll just, you know, Scarlett O'Hara wasn't going to think about it until tomorrow.
That's right.
And I said, I'm going to think about it for a whole month. I'm going to think, Lord, do things for Terry and I, do things for me that we don't even expect.
Amen.
You said, call upon me and I would show you great and mighty things that I know not. Lord, there's so much I don't know, so You've got a good field to work with. So, Lord, just keep showing me things and things I don't even expect You to do. Do it for me, Lord. And if we'll have that expectation, hope, confidence, expectancy, patience, joy, peace, and love, when we're trying to exercise an act of faith, God is able to develop in it. You know, happy are the people whose God is the Lord, that we are to be. Many of the women, Psalm says, are going to go out and preach the gospel in the last days. I mean, when we see our value and who we are in heaven and earth and hell, then there's no way you're going to give up on a prayer. And you're going to love prayer. And you want to go into prayer, let us go speedily to pray, as Zechariah, they said, let us go speedily to prayer.
Yes.
Everything has to be about all of that.
Amen.
And I think I've shared with you one other time in Daniel 4, where Daniel said, Nebuchadnezzar, I'll get through it. Nebuchadnezzar said, after I'd come back out of that field for 7 years, and he said, and I repented, he said, and I had the right use of my mind, and my reason and my understanding returned to me. Isn't that amazing? And then Daniel chapter 2 says, He knows what is in the darkness, and the light dwells with Him. Isn't that outstanding? I mean, when God knows what is out there in the dark, and you don't know, and the light dwells with Him, then I want to hear what God knows about that thing that I don't know anything about. So I hope I've whet your appetite. And I hope you have repented where you need to repent. And you've gotten excited and launched yourself into a new career where you're working for God in prayer. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Renee. Thank you so much.
You are welcome.
Awesome.
My, my.
I think we got a lot of ammo to load today. What do you think?
Well, and I didn't even pass this out, so we'll just,
oh, that's right.
We'll just save it for another time.
Okay. Or we can...
Well, go ahead and give it to them, and okay. Then I'll teach it another time
okay.
when they come.
Okay. That'd be wonderful. Yeah, because we want to... Because how many of you are going to go home and re-listen to these?
Yes.
Yeah. Because there was so much. It was so good. And it's important. Thank God for technology today that we can do that. You can just sit and soak. Soak it in, not, you know, be trying to write everything. Then go back. Listen again. Let you know, when I do this, I close my eyes. You need to do that, ladies, because especially if you're at home, because your eye will get on something you think you have to go do. So listen to the teaching again. Close your eyes. Listen. Let the Holy Spirit talk to you, and He's going to emphasize to you the things you need to work on, because we're all at different levels. And but there was so much good stuff. But I mean, literally, we can load our weapon, and our mouth is our weapon. Amen. Speaking the word of God and praying, and like she said, being committed to prayer. 5-minute prayer is good if that's all you've got. It's better than none. But when you can commit yourself to prayer, and you're full of the word, oh, your prayers are—they're reaching their target. They're accurate. They're aimed. They're focused. And you know, that's been the cry of my heart in prayer is, God, I don't want us just to fill up time to say we prayed an hour. I want it accurate. You know, you want to hit that target, because God's got things that need to be done today. He'll have things that need to be done tomorrow. And you want to be used of Him. You want to partner with Him and be able to not only see what to pray and know what to pray, but also to know what He's trying to do in you while you're praying that out. Because every time you do, things are changing you. I can't explain that. I just know it. That's how it works. It is. It's supernatural. As those plans are coming into your heart and going out of your mouth, it's changing you. And sometimes you'll realize something was changed in me that I knew needed changed, and I didn't even do anything about it. But because you were obedient to prayer and to work with God, what He had on His heart was more important to you than what you had on your heart.
Right. Exactly.
And like I was talking Sunday, you've got to knit your heart with God. Because when you knit your heart with God in prayer, then what's in His heart comes in your heart. You're knit. If you're knit, what are you? You're woven, aren't you? You're woven together. So what's in His heart is now a part of your heart. And as you pray it out, and earlier when Miss Renee was speaking, it's funny how the Holy Ghost will bring things to your remembrance. I have a friend, she's a sweet friend on Facebook. We went to school together many years ago. She's been a realtor for many years, and I love this, and because I know she's a believer, I know it's more than just, just a natural thing. On her cover photo of her Facebook page, it says, "Change your view and change your life." And when you were talking earlier, that came to my mind. Now, yeah, in the natural, being a realtor, buying a new home, changing your view can change your life. But if you will change your view, like Miss Renee was teaching us today, come up to the higher. If you change your view, you change your life. And I know you all know, because I speak a lot on Ephesians 1 and 2 about our place, that we're seated with Christ in the heavenly places far above. And the other morning, I was going over my scriptures, my prayer times at my kitchen table, looking out my back window. And anyway, I'm praying this, and like you were talking earlier, there's times you will just get so bold in your prayer. And, it's just very forceful. And I was praying over that, you know, when He raised Christ, He raised me. When He seated Christ, He seated me in Christ. And all of a sudden... And I've heard this said for years in church, and your pastor has said it. You know, we all know that what Jesus did, He did for us, of course, because He already had authority. He was, you know, the Son of God, one with God. So He already had authority, so we know everything He did for us. And I always looked at that as salvation, to be born again so I don't have to go to hell. Thank God, I'm happy for that. I can rejoice in that. But the Holy Ghost revealed to me that morning as I'm going over my scriptures, he did it so you could sit there. And I thought, I never saw it that way. He didn't just do it to save me from hell. He did it for me so I could sit there. That's the only way I could sit there. Because when he raised Christ, he raised us with him. And that, I mean, maybe y'all had already, I am a little slow, I know. It takes me a while sometimes to get things. But I had never seen that. He had to do that. He had to go through everything he went through, the horrible torture and everything he went through at the cross and going into hell for us. He had to do that so we could sit there, not just to keep us out of hell. He had to do that so we could sit in that seat with him in the heavenly places so we could change our view and we could change our life. Amen. And not only our lives, it's not just about us. We know that so we can change the world around us. Amen. Because we're his body now here. He wouldn't just be sitting around. He wouldn't be carnally, how did you say it? Carnal. Would he? No. Every day he knew what the Father's will was for him. He only did what he saw the Father do. He only said what he heard the Father say. And we've got to do the same thing as his body today. Every day we need to get our orders. I got my orders yesterday, and I didn't realize going to Bucky's was going to be a spiritual thing. You know, that's how simple it can be, hearing from God to know where to go today, because he knows who you're going to cross. Amen. Amen. So, yay, you just got me even more excited. Amen. Thank you so much.
And I wanted you to know just how when I was praying over this meeting, you know, mm-hmm. talking to you about this outline,
yes.
and everything, because you and I were on the same page on the word and prayer and yes. all of that agreeing together. And so I had written this about my favorite scriptures that keep faith simple. Just like you're saying about mm-hmm. that simple truth. I had never heard anybody say that. He did what he did so that I could sit there.
Yeah.
So that I could never sit there. That. But these are my five favorite scriptures. And even though I'm not, you know, here to answer your questions on it, just go through that and take what Kathy's been sharing and what we did today, and you'll put yourself through Bible school for about a month.
Amen.
And just bring yourself to another level of understanding of the quality of life God wants you to live.
Amen.
We live on a lower standard, much lower standard. You have to measure this from where I am today to eye hath not seen and ear hath not heard. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a big difference, you know.
Yes.
And so what God's trying to help us realize is that we're seated in a place in him at the right hand of authority to exercise that authority in prayer in the earth.
In prayer.
And if you'll keep it simple, these five scriptures here, that just go over the simple things because it helps you understand our objective and how to function and how to think in the place that God's called us to be in. And the enemy won't be able to make you dissatisfied in
Amen.
Torment and oppression. And because when you step into the realm of the Spirit, a lot of times everything hits you. And you have mm-hmm. to realize mm-hmm. which is which, good or evil.
Right.
And so these are the things that I think as ministers of the gospel, we just want everybody to avoid the distractions and the errors that you can get into and to keep you on the straight and narrow path that will only bless your life.
Amen. Thank you. Yes, only bless your life.
Only.
Only. Yes. And it's so, you know, one of the things I had prayed, I don't know, maybe a year or so ago, was, Lord, make me dissatisfied with everything else but you. And that's a wonderful place to be. And a lot of people, I don't think they want to pray that because they like being satisfied with earthly things. But, you know, I was like you. I wanted to watch John Wayne, but God said, go read your book.
It takes so much.
I know. You can learn some spiritual things through John Wayne.
Good
praise
stuff
God.
Is.
And I would try to reason out sometimes
right.
that
that's
way.
Right.
I say, but God, I know how this movie ends, and you know it's really spiritual. And you know, me and Daryl always laugh because John Wayne will kill you, but then he'll give you a good Christian burial. You know, he'll pray, he'll bury you, and he'll speak over you, but he's going to shoot you first. But anyway, so I always say, but you know, Lord, I can learn from the John Wayne movie. But it's true. When you learn that nothing else satisfies you, everything else will leave you empty.
That's right.
It will, and especially the day we're living in. I mean, chick flicks don't cut it for me anymore. I don't really have any anymore. They've gotten dust on them. And I think, wow, that used to really be, yeah. That brought me a good day. Isn't it funny?
Yeah.
I think some of it's probably maturity, getting older. But truly, I believe that when I prayed that, you know, you've got to give God permission.
Exactly.
That things started changing. And then you come up to that higher life. When you lose your life for the higher life, it's so worth it. It's so worth it. And yes, you might lose some friends. But that's okay. You've got he's your best friend. And you get so close to him. When your relationship with him is so close, when you can just sit down and close your eyes and say three words and you're already in the spirit with him. Woo! When it used to take you an hour and you're still struggling to break through in prayer, but now it can only take a few words and you're there. It's all worth it. It's all worth it. Everything you give up, then you look back and go, why was that such a big deal to me? How did that bring me, you know, joy?
Hallelujah.
Something that superficial, you know.
Amen.
When you can have an audience with God, the Creator, the one you're going to spend eternity with, you know, and when I make my confession in the morning that's, you know, that talks about, I've been given, he's been seated far above all principality, power, might, and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this age and world, but also in that which is to come. And all of a sudden, the Spirit kind of give you a glimpse of what is to come. And then it's like, oh my goodness. I've known this for a long time. He spoke it to me this way, and I've spoken it to y'all. This time on earth is the shortest span of our existence. This time before we're with him, it's the shortest span of our existence. We're going to live forever. Like, I love what Miss Renee used to tell her kids. You know, don't worry about it, honey. You're going to live forever. How did you say it?
But we didn't get to go to Toys R Us.
Yes. That's right. You're not going to miss a thing. You're going to live forever. You're not going to miss a thing.
Right.
And when we can realize that and say, God, this is my gift to you.
Amen.
This time of my life is my gift to you. So what would you have me to do today? Yes, I might want to go stroll around TJ Maxx. And man, if I wanted to do that after all this, you know. And I don't always have to shop. Was it Miss Donna was teasing me about shopping a lot. I said, I don't really shop a lot. I just like to walk and look, you know. I'm not always buying. Sometimes I am, but not always. But anyway, how did I get off on that? Oh, no. What was the spiritual thing behind it? Yes. Thank you, Miss Cheryl. This time of our lives be his gift, our gift to him. So what would you have me do today, Father?
Yeah.
He can use you supernaturally in the natural, and he can use you supernaturally in the spirit.
That's right.
There's been days I know, okay, I want to use you supernaturally today, but I didn't leave my house. It was all through prayer. He might want to use you supernaturally at the grocery store to lay hands on somebody, or at a team roping, or wherever you go, or barrel racing. You know, wherever you go, in your bakery. But he also wants to use you supernaturally in your closet, where no one else sees you, and you're not seeing anybody but him. Amen. Amen. So, wow, I wish we could go a little longer or another day or, but I know you need to get some rest and you got services tomorrow. Yeah. Amen. Praise God. Well, we do want to take an offering for Miss Renee. So for those streaming, you can do that as well. We do ask if you have the option there to, do they have that, honey, on Subsplash and PayPal? Okay. To please say that it is for Mrs. Renee Mize. And because I know some people give their tithe and offering on Saturdays to the church that are partners. But please specify that for Mrs. Renee. Amen. So we're going to have a basket up here. Are you going to put that out for me, ladies? Thank you so much. Oops. The top one. The second one's the, our raffle tickets. Yes, and don't forget your stuff, ladies. Your good stuff. You don't want to miss it. Thank you, Anouk, again, for doing that for all of us. That way, everybody's going to have something. Although I think everybody did win a prize. I love that. That's fun. I love giving stuff away. But I just want to pray over you. Before we go, after we pray, you can come and bring your offering to the front. But if you'll stand. Amen. Well, Father, we are just so thankful for what you have given us today through Mrs. Renee. Thank you, Father, for a woman of God. Who has dedicated her life to you and to prayer. Not just for her and her family, but so she could strengthen the body. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for blessing her through everything she's gone through and sacrificed for the kingdom. And we thank you that only you can repay her for that. No offering is a big enough amount. But we thank you that you repay her for that. Thank you, Father. You reward her, I should say. You reward her for that. Thank you, Father. Oh, we love you. We thank you for calling us your own. Thank you for risking your good name on us. And forgive us when we've failed. But thank you, you've been so faithful and patient and loving. You forgive us. You stand us back up. Give us a little nudge and get us going again. And we are so thankful. So, Father, I just ask that every seed that's been sown today in our hearts takes root. In Jesus' name, that we are good ground. We're not going to let the enemy steal this from us in any way. In Jesus' name, we declare our hearts good ground. And we do what's necessary to make it good ground. We're not going to let the cares of this world, desires for other things, come in and steal it from us. In Jesus' name. We're not going to let persecution for the word's sake stop us. In Jesus' name. No obstacle in our path stop us. I thank you. We have the weapons we need. And as we speak the name and the blood of Jesus, we see those things that are hindering moved out of our path. And we go forward, straight before us on that path you have laid for us. And we thank you, Father God, that in the days ahead, in the months ahead, we're going to see our lives only progressing, going higher and higher with you, because we choose to dedicate our lives, not only to you, Father, as your children, as your daughters, your maidservants that you promise to pour your spirit out on in these last days, but as prayers, Father. Yes, as prayers to go forth and do your will in the earth. You can depend on us, Father. We commit ourselves. We commit ourselves and dedicate ourselves to a lifestyle of prayer, of the word and prayer. The most powerful prayer we can pray, packed full of the word that never returns to you void, forever settled in heaven, never to pass away. thank you for preserving your word for us, Father. And we just take it today with a seriousness in our spirits, to let this not just be a fun day, but to go out of here with a new perspective and a different view. In Jesus' name. And we thank you for it. I pray as we leave today that you bless each and every one of the ladies. That I thank you we all reach our destination safely and without incident. Psalms 91 covers us. And I thank you, Father, you bring us all back here tomorrow for another powerful day in the Word. We're so blessed, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.